At this particular panel, I am not going to take any of your time telling you things that you know. I'm going to assume everyone here knows something about the IoT and how it works, that we all are familiar with the figures for the billions of devices that are or will be deployed and connected, that we understand how pervasive, ubiquitous it will be in our society, that we appreciate all the sectors of industry and commerce that will be affected. I'm also going to assume that you know already many of the attack vectors, some of the technical methods by which the IoT is delivered. So we're not going to talk about the things you know. We will talk about some things that you probably or may not know. One is that we're going to draw upon our Washington perspective and some of the work we do with the Department of Defense and related agencies to give you a little bit of the threat picture. We are also going to talk about the range of things that the government can do, and there is a long list of possibilities and a long roster of entities that can participate. And we're going to give you some recommendations as to what we think the government should do. And lastly, and hopefully most important, we will conclude with a call to action, because we think that everyone in this room has a role to play in responding to the security issues presented by the IoT. So with that, let me introduce my colleagues on the panel. Dan Caprio is immediately to my left. He's the co-founder of the Providence Group. He advises enterprises on risk, security, and privacy. Previously served in the government with the Department of Commerce and the Federal Trade Commission. To his left is Harvey Rishikof. Harvey is a past chair of the American Bar Association Standing Committee on Law and National Security, a prolific author. He has had notable positions in the Department of Defense, the intelligence community, and the FBI. And as it happens, Harvey and I are working together at present on a DOD-funded study of a national supply chain security strategy. Myself, I'm a lawyer in private practice. I advise U.S. and international technology companies on cyber and supply chain security and public contracting. As a special government employee, I was a member of the Defense Science Board, which produced a report on cyber supply chain in 2017. Let's dive in. So we're going to start with a kind of quick discussion of the nature of the threat so that everyone can take appropriate, take it with appropriate seriousness. You know, for those of you who have come here a few years, I'm relatively new, like this is my third example here. You know, for years people have been writing about how the IoT is going to come to us, and with it will come both wonderful opportunity and new vulnerabilities. Well, those predictions are true. I mean, the expectation is now the actuality. You know, we're in a situation where the IoT is around us, upon us. It is coming everywhere we know about, many places that we don't, and their list of vendors and applications is almost limitless. And because of the nature of connected systems, we have to worry about different types of threats and consequences. A lot of the federal interest in security historically is focused upon network security and protection of the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of information. With the IoT, we have to consider other things. We have to consider risks to safety. We have to consider impacts to privacy. We have to consider the functionality of connected systems. We also have to appreciate that the number of attack surfaces expands almost exponentially, that the supply chain can, has been, and will be used by adversaries to exploit the IoT for political or economic effect. And we have to recognize also that although some attacks through the IoT will be targeted, others will have collateral or cascading effects across even unintended audiences or instrumentalities. And lastly, as I think is illustrated by the social media furor over Facebook, I think people are going to realize that there is a massive privacy challenge, at least, posed by the IoT, because it involves on the consumer side the collection of almost incalculable amounts of data about individual. And typically, the collection of that data is accompanied by the aggregation, processing, application of artificial intelligence, and the use of algorithms to predict and act upon what is learned about individuals. So with that, let me turn the next topic over to Dan, and that is to discuss how we as a matter of strategy, try to reconcile risk and opportunity of the IoT.
Well, thanks, Bob, and thanks, everyone, for joining us today. As you all know, I mean, there are tremendous opportunities and challenges with the IoT on the innovation side in terms of economic growth, development. You know, you've all seen the McKinsey studies, whether it's in agriculture, automobiles, smart grid, transportation, sustainable development, the efficiency arguments. I mean, those are all very real and something that we should all encourage. But on the challenge side, when it comes to the IoT, and I've been coming to RSA for probably 15 years now. And so what's really frightening is that all the things that we were talking about back then are now coming true in spades, and the IoT is a big part of that. So we really are in what I consider uncharted territory in terms of connect the way the IoT, the connected systems intensify the risk. Heard the Cisco keynote yesterday, and the figure that by 2020 we'll have 200 billion connected devices. So that number just keeps growing exponentially. That's actually not really the bad news. The worst news is, I mean, all those devices are beginning to make their way into enterprise systems. I heard Amit Uran on Monday at Tenable quote a study that said that there were, of those 200 billion devices, but there were already 10 billion devices or assets in enterprise networks. So the innovation side is real, but the challenge that we're really beginning to see is how do we protect the enterprise.
So I'm going to turn next to Harvey to talk about a range of responses, but with this preface. The term weaponization is being used recently for a lot of things in the cyber area, and I'm reluctant to use it again here because it can sort of be diluted by over-emphasis. But we are in a world whereas physical systems, factories, transportation, infrastructure become dependent on sensor-enabled networks. Our adversaries, who are real and who are smart and who do harbor adverse motives, they do have the ability to conduct what's now being called asymmetric warfare by weaponizing vulnerabilities and methods of attack into IoT-enabled functions. And as the IoT becomes more at the core of so many parts of our government, our vulnerability to those attacks for political or economic gain increases. Harvey?
Well, first, thanks, Bob. Also, let me make the traditional disclaimer. I'm here speaking on my own behalf and not any of the entities that I'm associated with. The first is that the IoT is here and the law is not. So we're in an extraordinary role of playing catch-up again in this particular sphere. Security is not keeping pace with IoT deployment of threat trends is the bullet, and as Bob mentioned, in the law we refer to the space below the projection of force as the gray area. It's before you trip over under the convention, United Nations General Convention of 51, as to whether or not you're in a projection of hostilities. And the IoT is a new extraordinary space that allows malicious actors to, as Bob would say, weaponize the space. So you have on one end of the spectrum the military side, and on the left side of the spectrum it's just general either maliciousness or criminality. So how do we normally respond to these issues? We only have a finite number of hammers to deal with this problem, and usually we use the market. The market is usually a mechanism that we use to discipline any area that we think is evolving. Unclear if the market will be able to do this job, because in greed versus security, greed usually wins, and historically has been winning. Another potential hammer is regulation. So you notice there's a number of bills on the Hill, which we'll get into a little bit later. But regulation becomes complicated because it's unclear if, with all due respect to the Congress, whether they have the finite ability to fine-tune and understand the consequences of actions that they're taking. And then the third way we usually regulate or respond is litigation. So how many people in this room are lawyers? Raise your hand. Not enough. Okay. How many of you can write an algorithm? Raise your hand. These are the more dangerous people in the room. How many of you own a Bitcoin? It's interesting that correlate between people who can write algorithms also own Bitcoins. And finally, how many of you have spent time on the dark web? Okay, lower your hand. It's a quick trick question. if you spend way too much time, come and see me. But what you're seeing is the wage of response to those phenomena is basically testing the system. So the Attorney General of New York has just notified about 15 Bitcoin companies that he sent them a set of questionnaires and wants them to respond to them because he's worrying about trying to protect consumers in this particular area of cryptocurrency. So we'll get into it more about the range of responses, but what I will say to you is we have a finite number of tools and that this marketplace is not only domestic but international. So also what plays in the system are other countries and other forms of treaties and other international organizations.
And that, you know, illustrates the problem. I mean, there may be an almost unlimited number of participants who could have an economic interest in the promotion of the IoT, who will benefit from the advances in functionality that it will bring, who will make money by investing in it. And there is also an almost limitless number of committees, agencies, departments, states, and local governments who are going to become affected by it and who will express some level of interest in trying to protect us against it while promoting the IoT at the same time.
So I just will quickly make a one-finger response. We've created two markets. One market is that software market, the IoT market, which is speed to marketplace as opposed to security. Mm-hmm. And we're now creating another market, which many of you are involved in, which is the cybersecurity market. And the cybersecurity market tries at the same time to respond to the cyber software market. Both markets are extremely efficient in a sense they both make a lot of money, but they're extraordinarily inefficient because we still have all the vulnerabilities.
And I would follow that by saying this. You don't have to drive very far in Washington to find some agency or regulatory body or interest group trade association that wants to have a hand in the IoT, either to get it, to promote it, or to protect against it. But very few of them act in any fashion that is coordinated. And the absence of coordination plus the relatively or always slow pace of many of these actions means that in this technology-driven, highly profitable market, the IoT is being deployed and is changing way faster than the government is able to react to it. You know, sometimes people ask whether there could be a prescriptive regime for regulation, and I would say, no, there can't be, if only because by the time that you actually wrote the regulation down and got it approved, the technology would move on, the use cases would have changed. Let's talk about standards and best practices, Dan, and what role they can play.
Well, they can play a very useful and important role. One of the things that we're seeing with the IoT is just a proliferation of standards or work within consortia. You know, groups that have popped up all over the place. And I guess over time, you know, some small handful of those will prevail. But right now, what seems to be happening is that there's a lot that's happening on the proprietary side, which is not going to do much for interoperability. And there's also the international standards bodies have been kind of slow to act, which is typical. I mean, the standard setting process takes some amount of time. So the good news is there's a lot of players. The challenge right now is that it's not moving quickly enough, and that some of the outcomes are, at least for now, look to be proprietary and in nature.
Where does the GDPR fit into this, Dan?
Well, The GDPR, which, I mean, we've talked about that a lot at the conference, so that takes effect in May 25th. So that's really related to privacy and security in Europe, but I mean, that's gonna raise the bar around the world. And so to the extent that the IoT plays into that, you're gonna have to be able to answer the same sorts of questions about devices in your network, what kind of information is collected, and how is it protected as a regulatory matter. And the thing that's gotten everyone's attention about GDPR, whether it's the IoT or the rest of personally identifiable information, is the fine. So it's a competition level fine, you know, 4% of global revenue. And the Europeans are, as we see in other matters, I think will not hesitate to levy that kind of fine.
I think the other aspect about GDPR is that, so if you look at the logic of the social media and where we are in IoT, it's all about monetizing the information. And that's the name of the game. And what the GDPR does is helps to make the individual own their information. So if you start owning your own information and data, whether or not it's going to be used or not, A, you have to be compensated for, and B, you have to understand what's happening to it. That's a game changer inside the understanding of privacy. And the other entity that you don't think of much in this process for standards and best practices is Department of Defense. So the NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, is giving unbelievable senses of authority and power to the DoD, and particularly in the supply chain side of issues, and the issues of being trying to do a cybersecurity policy has now been tasked to the Secretary of Defense. So it's, and also like other parts of government, the DoD budget is usually a smidgen larger than other departments inside the process. So when you follow the money, there's a great deal of power and authority. And so the defense industrial base, the big players, that's another sort of best practices that's being used in order to signal to the marketplace of what will be considered appropriate inside security, inside the IoT.
I would say this, however, Harvey. You know, everybody, does anybody here know NIST Special Publication 853? Okay. Has anyone actually tried to carry it along with 800-160 or 161 at one time?
So
it's hard.
This is why I have to be at the RSA, because you say that and like
I know,
17
everyone,
hands
everyone
go
does it. I mean, those NIST does an incredible job, but they're just starting, just really starting. There was a meeting yesterday just to kind of map the agenda and the process for a special publication for the IoT. We don't really have established the norms as to either process, mechanics, controls, or enhancements for the IoT. And that presents a lot of problems. I mean, DoD has said, we want to buy more of the IoT, but we need special contract clauses, and we need to know what controls and practices we should expect of our vendors, but they don't exist. You know, there are many sectoral specialists, standard setting bodies that are working through these, and some are further than others. But even in the ones that maybe have invested the most, such as for autonomous automobiles, you know, is there a standard yet that is trustworthy that you would rely upon? I think not. The IoT is being deployed around us. Its importance is increasing, and yet we really don't have norms in the form of standards and practices yet that we can rely on. Now, I have this last float-in thing that says changing public perception. This is a bit of a prediction. I think that there will be a wave that follows the social media outrage to Facebook, where the public is going to appreciate the benefits of the IoT but become wary of what it means to their individual freedoms and their privacy rights. And I don't think it will require the public to think too hard to realize that as data about them is being collected, they also have to be concerned both about how it's used and whether it is kept secure. So, you know, if the first slide was to kind of describe for us the problem, our second slide is to present some of the choices. And the issue really before this panel, before government at every level, is what role do we want the government to play and when? And ultimately, it sort of distills to, you know, a risk management question. Should the government wait, let industry do as much as it can, hope for the best, protect the necessary, and then learn the lessons of a trauma or a calamity, or should it act sooner? And if it does act sooner, how can the U.S. government, which is influential, helpful influence on a global market where many of the technologies are not from the U.S. One approach is to rely on industry, and I think we have to, because ultimately industry is the source of design and development, software, manufacturing, deployment, maintenance, support of the IoT. And industry does have technologies that are really important to, and people at this conference can add value through new software or hardware methods to defend the IoT. But we can't trust everyone in industry because, as Harvey mentioned, for many companies, the fastest path to the market is the objective. And return on investment from additional security measures does not exist. It's not present, it's negative return. So we have to deal with this distinction between the best companies, many of which are here, and those that are not so good, who will create exposure. What about government leadership, by example, Dan? Where can the and roles and missions, what do you see as the appropriate role for government? How urgent is it that the government act?
Well, I think, at least on the unclassified side, there's been a tremendous amount of government leadership. A couple that come to mind, the Federal Trade Commission has brought a couple of cases related to the Internet of Things. And so those, you know, sort of become a common law precedent for best practices. In some of the cases the FTC has brought, you just kind of scratch your head and think, you know, why would a company, I mean, I think to Harvey's point, it's just the rush to market and to monetize data and an application just got in the way of security. And you know, the moral of that story is you don't want to be the company with a 20-year consent order from the Federal Trade Commission. And the FTC's also issued guidance and a report, which is very helpful around the Internet of Things. I see my colleague Alan Friedman in the audience. Alan and his colleagues at NTIA have done tremendous work around the Internet of Things, the multi-stakeholder process, white papers, Alan's work on patch management. It's been outstanding, and it's the way the government should work. The other thing that is actually kind of happening in real time is the work that NIST is doing. They just had a meeting this morning about a paper that they're working on that's going to be out in the fall in September of 2018, which is an introduction to managing IoT cyber and privacy risk. And it's described as a document to help federal agencies manage IoT cybersecurity and privacy risk. And this is the key, is that it's, you know, aimed at a practical approach to IoT cybersecurity and risk. So the key, and we keep saying this, but this relates to the NIST cybersecurity framework, now 1.1, and the risk management approach that NIST is incorporating in this, and so that it brings IoT cybersecurity and privacy, managing and mitigating those risks at the strategic level across the enterprise. And so a couple of things about how they're going to do that. Again, it's the risk management approach. They understand, as NTIA understands it as well, that it's an ecosystem of things. We're looking at devices. No, devices don't exist in a vacuum. That NIST is looking at an outcome-based approach, and that no one size fits all. So really, the work that NIST is doing, in my way of thinking, really is the best game in town on the unclassified side. And I think it's really up to all of us who care and have an interest in the Internet of Things and in privacy and cybersecurity risk management to be involved in that process.
Now, I'm a great admirer of NIST also, but the framework, along with essentially every and any other NIST publication, is a matter of voluntary adherence. Some will choose to adopt it, some will do it well, and many will choose not to, and some will say they will do it but won't. Now, ordinarily, in a group like this, being a lawyer is not an advantage. It's probably still true. And generally, we don't associate lawyers with security. And we certainly don't think about lawsuits as promoting security. But there is an argument that as concerns the IoT, that liability does have an important role in assuring security. And you have to create that argument, Harvey.
Well, it's quite easy. You know, we're lawyers and come here to help, as you know. So you know an issue is critical when the ABA Journal makes it a cover for the legal communities. We're about 350,000 lawyers in the ABA. So when you make the cover, it's critical. And this cover says, the dangers of digital things, writing the laws when driverless cars or other computerized products take a wrong turn. So we call it the big L word, liability, but it's all about classification. I don't know how many of you know George Lakoff's work. So he talks about vocabulary and all about classification. He has a famous book called Women, Fire, and Other Dangerous Things. It's how some cultures classify what's dangerous. So how we classify what's dangerous is how we associate what liability is. And we're starting to see for the first time this taking forward. I will use the K word, Kaspersky. And for the first time, the Department of Homeland Security used the binding directives, operational directives, called out a particular company and said that they, if you were a federal entity, you could not be on, it should not be on your networks. Kaspersky, of course, hired lawyers. They are now suing DHS for violation of the Administrative Procedures Act, that there had not been appropriate due process. So we're going to start a new whole range of litigation about how when the government identifies an entity, and then B, how that identified entity has due process in order for it to respond to the issue. And this is one of the themes of this session is understanding why, you know, our national interest is, and national security is being raised by the IoT issue. Well, the argument is, theoretically, we separate church and state in this, in our democracy, and we also separate industry and government. Many of our adversaries do not separate industry and government, nor do they separate industry, government, and criminal activity. So they're able to use those three instruments for their own national interest. And we're starting to see this come bubbling up inside the IoT, inside the networks. And I think it's causing a great deal of concern for us, USG, as to what is the appropriate way to respond. And the second issue in our bullet is marketplace self-discipline. So how many of you are on Facebook?
How many will admit your it today than 2 weeks
ago? How many have checked your settings? How many have changed your settings as a result of the testimony of Zuckerberg? So that's usually what we call market discipline, is when you don't like that product and you then vote with your feet or you vote with your dollars. But it's how many of you dropped Facebook as a result of learning what it was doing with your information? Only two people. The rest of you have stayed on the platform. And that's why we say, is there going to be market self-discipline by the consumers, given their right, their love
Harvey,
and commitment
if I
to
may,
this? Yes.
One of the differences with the IoT that is troublesome is the loss of control by most consumers who use the IoT over whether they are going to use it, whether they can stop using it, whether they can choose how it is being used, whether they will know about the data that is being disclosed about them, and whether they can essentially self-correct any errors. The answer to all of those essentially being no.
Well, you know the famous article, I don't want my toaster to talk to my fridge.
Right.
And that's going to be the issue of where we have breaks. And as Bob is saying, you, the consumers, are going to have to decide what do you enjoy because it makes it convenient, versus your concern of the amount of information that is being collected by private sector then that is using that information to help commoditize you as a person and to make your life easier.
So I want to move us to the next slide. I'm going to quickly summarize executive branch action and sector specific initiatives. There's essentially every regulatory agency is interested in the IoT and everybody's studying it and there's lots of reports. And some of the sectoral agencies, particularly the FTC on the enforcement side and the FCC on spectrum, you know, they have very powerful leverage. And FERC has the opportunity to influence the utilities that are at risk of IoT exposure. So the regulatory agencies have a role to play, and the procurement agencies have a role to play. But, I mean, if you were to compare this to supply chain or network attacks, the level of attention in the executive branch right now is small. Mm-hmm. And yet the scale, scope of the problem is extremely large. And I believe, unfortunately, that we are going to see adversaries move many of their attacks against our national interest into the veins, if you will, of the IoT. Because it's so, there are so many places to attack. There are so many vulnerabilities. And there are ways to create either kinetic or economic effects that are almost impossible to attribute. And those are unfortunately attributes of a successful attack in the minds of some of our adversaries. Harvey, Dan, do you want to speak about international measures and how those might address these problems?
Well, I spend a lot of time in Europe on all things transatlantic. And so, and we've already talked about GDPR, but I don't know how many of you heard Vice President ANSIP yesterday, but the European Commission has been, or Europe has been very interested in sort of the creation of a digital single market. And the Internet of Things is a big part of that because they're trying to create new national champions in Europe. So that's something to keep an eye on. The other thing that is percolating at a very high level is some work in the Internet Governance Forum, kind of voluntary global set of best practices for the Internet of Things, because we tend to think about it from a developing or developed world perspective with privacy and cybersecurity and protecting systems and networks and enterprises. But it's a whole different equation in the developing world, where some of those efficiency gains that I talked about earlier just make a huge difference in terms of quality of life. So we're seeing, you know, a lot of policy attention in Europe and just massive, massive amounts of investment top down in China and, you know, the acceleration of systems in Asia Pacific. So we are not, from the U.S. perspective, we're not in the same driver's seat that we usually are with new technology. If anything, I mean, Asia Pacific and China is probably, the last time I saw, I mean, roughly 50% of the market. The U.S. is about a quarter, and Europe is about a quarter. So it's a whole new paradigm.
So I'll make three quick points. The first is, we were at the U.N., we had the UNGGE. We were trying to have meetings 2014-15. We reached the high point in 2015. And subsequent to that, the last 2016-17 meeting came to no real resolution. And that's because we're seeing the world fragment in the international world between and among a variety of sovereigns. Mm-hmm. And those sovereigns are taking different perspectives about how they want to clamp down on the internet and how they want to clamp down and the flow of information. The second point is that there's a new game, and the new game is 5G. Mm. And our adversaries are playing quite aggressively in the 5G space. It's unclear what our game is like in the 5G space. And people do think that this will be a bit of a game changer, given what it will mean for the spectrum and control. And then thirdly, there's a whole range of international institutions like the IEE, we call like the geek world. And the geek world is extremely significant in establishing standards and establishing what the protocols will be. And again, our adversaries are extremely aggressive in this. We say the H word, Huawei and ZTE, they are extremely looking for market share. They are in the international realm trying to buy up critical infrastructure, and the West is acting in a variety of ways how to deal with this sort of international experience that we're having. And as Dan pointed out, they're taking AI and ML really seriously. They have a very considered effort. Unclear what our commitment is to AI and ML. We have a private sector, and then I'll end with certain private sector companies are believing that they would like to have a digital Geneva Convention. So we have another huge actor that is a sovereign, and I say the apps and products are sovereign in competition with our sovereigns. And that's a new sort of world.
Right.
Years ago, there used to be Sovereignty at Bay was an issue that was a book that was written. I think it's coming back.
So, you know, I think the consensus among our panel, although we come from different backgrounds, is that the government should intervene. And it should do so sooner than later, because later could well be too late, and there could be dire economic, even physical consequences, injury. It isn't likely to happen just, you know, from some casual hacker looking to make money from ransomware, although that will happen too. You know, we are in an area of increasing superpower or peer power competition, and we have just too many examples to count to show that the adversaries are willing to do very bad things that affect our country. And the Internet of Things will become a battlefield of choice. So I would like to ask Harvey and Dan to talk about federal government regulation and direction. And I put a number of categories up there. Dan, do you want to start? Harvey, go next.
Yeah.
Well, we've mentioned a couple of these already, but you know what we're in the absence of a national strategy, if you will, in the U.S., we're seeing the FCC look at and Commerce obviously look at 5G, but ways to thinking about regulating the Internet of Things. I mean, so FERC, utilities. The SEC in terms of what is considered a material risk, which is that's been a topic of discussion. The FDA, we haven't spent any time on that, but it's like the medical devices and the connected systems and networks and what this means in hospital systems. I mean, it's scary how insecure some of these things are, but what we're seeing is a siloed approach. Everybody just kind of doing their thing in their silo. And you know, as we mentioned earlier, the FTC bringing some enforcement actions where it can, and DOJ beginning to. And Harvey's going to speak to that. But you know, we're beyond the tipping point. I mean, we've been talking about Facebook and sort of the issue of trust. But when you start to look at some of these things, especially at the FDA, and when you're talking about patient health and safety, you know, when that pendulum starts to swing, as it already is, into loss of life, then I think it's gonna attract attention. We've really already had our significant moment, the dying DDoS attack, which actually went to the DNS. The only reason that didn't capture anyone's imagination is because members on the Hill just couldn't understand it. But I mean, we know what I mean. And like Bob said, that's just the tip of the iceberg.
So, Harvey, could you talk about enforcement?
Sure.
Our time is limited, but I do want you especially to talk about the difficulty of involving DOD, DHS, and the IC all together and why it's important.
Yeah. So it's PII. You know it as personal identified information, but as a Fed, I know it as prosecution, immunity, and information. Hmm. So that's my PII. As Bob is pointing out, when we have to be effective in prosecution, when we indicted the five PLA members in China for their IP theft, that was a game changer. Can DOJ start prosecuting in a much more aggressive way when they see these violations is going to be the challenge. The immunity is, in order to get the information for the prosecutions, we have to give immunity to the players. They're fearful of negligence. The information is in the hands of the private sector. It's all their logs. And being able to have access to that gives us a sense of what the PTTs are and allows us to go forward. And finally, information sharing. We've been talking about this for since I've been doing this for over 20 years. Mm-hmm. But now we're talking about the necessity for us to have some form of a national supply information center where we're able to sit down and tell the private sector we will privilege the information over prosecution, and we'll give you immunity, because we need to be able to have access and vector into it in order to respond in an appropriate way.
Yeah, and by the same token, Harvey and I do work in this area, and I have to give the same disclaimer. Nothing that I say should be attributed to the Defense Science Board or the Department of Defense. We see tremendous efforts being made by DHS. It's getting its arms around a lot of supply chain and other cyber issues. And we see increasing interest in those subjects on the Hill. And DOD, of course, is very interested. But there are separations between the intelligence community, so-called Title 50 agencies, DOD, the Title 10 agencies, and all the civilian agencies who are subject to FISMA, which DOD and the IC are not. And yet we really are dealing with a common source or sources of threat. And one of the great challenges is finding a way to use our threat intelligence and to inform our industry and our civil agencies on what they should expect and how they should respond.
So we call it the Title 50, Title 10, Title 18 problem. Title 10 is DOD, Title 50 is the intelligence, and Title 18 is DOJ's criminal authorities. We've created the silos of authorities when the problem is coming at us that our adversaries do not have a similar problem in falling under our categories. And then ultimately, there's always an issue of attention with the intelligence community, which is, are they willing to give up their sources and methods in order for us to go forward? Because when you use in cyber, you're one and done. Once you use a zero day, you're done. Once you expose the vulnerability, you're done. So there's an incredible strategic question that we have, that Bob has put his finger on, among our communities about how we act with the whole of government in order to be effective, in order for us to demonstrate to entities that are exploiting the weaknesses of both the software and the hardware and the carbon units, you know them as people. These are the things that we're trying to figure out, and we've launched huge insider threat programs, but as Bob has pointed out, it's an incredible challenge among the different entities.
So we're a little short of time, Dan. I'd like you to take on the question of what you think Congress can do and should do, and where you see a role for state and local government to play.
Well, so Congress fits into this whole of government approach that we've been discussing. I mean, we are beginning to see, some level of interest in legislation. There's the Warner-Gardner bill around government procurement, which is important. The Senator Markey and Congressman Liu introduced a bill, which is really more of a voluntary certification. So, and we see state government beginning to finally, not necessarily the Internet of Things, but finally get their head around cybersecurity and the need to treat privacy and cyber as risk management. So really the short answer to the question is, to really make this work, we need the political will in the legislative branch and the executive branch to really make some hard choices that we've kind of not addressed some of the hard problems, but I think what we need out of Congress and the executive branch and state government is just the political will to really think much more strictly about how we secure systems and networks.
So we're almost done, and I'm going to try to get to kind of the closing points. We don't see this as a sectoral problem. We don't see it as an agency problem. We don't see it as an industrial problem, a consumer problem. We don't even see it as a United States problem, but of course that is our principal concern. We see this as perhaps not even a whole of government problem, although the whole of government should coordinate its activities. It is a whole of society. It involves the designers and developers, the manufacturers, the operators of IoT instrumentalities, the sources of software, the communication service providers, the cloud service providers, those who are writing the algorithms. Everyone who is at this conference, in one way or another, is or will be a participant in the design, development, operation, securing, and response to the IoT. And I guess our call to action, then I'll go over to Harvey, is to ask each of you to try to take up to your management the proposition that IoT security demands attention by all of us across all of our industry and all of our government, and it needs that attention now.
Those of you who remember, old enough to remember the 60s, you're either part of the solution or you're part of the problem. And if we don't resolve it, my legal advice is I would enroll your children in Mandarin courses.
All right, so we are out of time. Thank you very much for your interest and attention. I appreciate we didn't have time for questions, but the three of us are certainly accessible and can be outside and able to respond to any questions you've got. Thanks again.